Hello friends, welcome to EduTap. This is the Fast Track series for RBI Grade B 2018, a video series brought to you by EduTap. So this series is all about the comprehensive coverage of current affairs from May 2018 to August 15th, 2018. We also aim to cover ESI and FM concepts through the MCQs. Our results for previous year have been really good. Last year, 124 EduTapians reached the interview stage and 27 could make it to the final list. Here you can see various courses offered by EduTap along with their MRP. Currently, we are running a discount of 30%. You just need to use the coupon code FLASH30. Okay, so let us move to the first news of... Okay, let's proceed to the first news of the day. 10th meeting of Global Alliance to Eliminate Lymphatic Filariasis held in New Delhi. Sri J.P. Nadda, the Union Minister of Health and Family Welfare, inaugurated the 10th meeting of Global Alliance to Eliminate Lymphatic Filariasis. Now, this particular news is important because this meeting has been held in India for the second time after the first meet was held in 2002. And coming further, you need to know what is lymphatic filariasis. It is also known as elephantiasis, that is hathi pau in Hindi. It is considered as one of the oldest and most debilitating neglected disease. It is endemic to 73 countries and India is also one of those countries. Elephantiasis is a parasitic disease which is caused by filarial worm, hence its name filariasis. So these were the important takeaways from this particular news. Let us move further. US government approves sale of AH-64E Apache attack helicopters to India. Now in this news, you need to know that Apache attack helicopters, as they are known as Apache Guardians, are a multi-role combat helicopters. And secondly, they are being offered to India by United States. So these are the two important information from this news you need to remember. Our third news is Dr. Bindeshwar Pathak, the founder of Sulabh International, has been honored with Nikki Asia Prize. Now this Nikki Asia Prize is given in Japan and Dr. Bindeshwar Pathak has been awarded this for his contribution to Asia's development. See, about this particular news, apart from knowing that Nikki Asia Prize has been given by Japan, we need to know furthermore about Dr. Bindeshwar Pathak, as he is particularly an important personality for you guys to know. Let us see about Dr. Pathak now. He founded Sulabh International in 1970. Sulabh International is an NGO that works to promote human rights, environmental sanitation, among other social services. Now, you guys must have seen Sulabh toilets somewhere around the public places. These toilets have been built by the NGO Sulabh International. So they aim for the removal of the manual labor for removing the human waste. So this is the aim of Sulabh International. Mr. Bindeshwar Pathak is the brand ambassador of Swachh Rail Mission for Indian Railways. This is also an important piece of information. And he has been awarded Lal Bahadur Shastri National Award for Excellence in 2017 for his works, the social services he is involved into, and he is also a Padma Bhushan awardee of 1992. On 12th July 2017, Mr. Pathak also launched a book called Narendra Modi, The Making of a Legend. Thus, he is the author of this particular book. So, these are all the information regarding Mr. Pathak you guys need to remember. Okay, so our next news is Cabinet approves the repositioning of Northeastern Council. Northeastern Council, Union Home Minister has been approved to be the ex-officio chairman of Northeastern Council. Ex-officio as in whosoever is the Home Minister is going to be by default the Chairman of Northeastern Council. And Cabinet has also approved Minister of State, Independent Charge, would serve as the Vice Chairman of the Council. So these are two important takeaways. And you have to know that NEC, Northeastern Council, is a statutory body. That is, it is mentioned in the statute of the Parliament. along with governors and chief ministers of all 8 members as its members. Now, what is the relevance of this particular arrangement? See, through this particular arrangement, making the Union Home Minister as the chairman, the interstate matters would be discussed more comprehensively now. The Northeastern Council consists of 8 members, out of which 7 are Northeastern Seven Sisters plus Sikkim. So you can read about this information here more. And let me tell you one more important point here. The council has to be given the powers as may be delegated to it by central government. That means the powers which will be given to it by central government, it will run on those powers. So this was all about this particular news. So moving to our next news, Integrated Command and Control Center of Naya Raipur Smart City inaugurated by Prime Minister. Now the Naya Raipur, it is the capital city of Chhattisgarh and it has become the 10th smart city center to be operational in the country. Smart city center means the control center of the smart city, as smart city is the digitally accessible city. So the smart city's mission is particularly important for us and we will have a deeper look into the mission. But moving forward, let me tell you that Naya Raipur is India's first greenfield smart city. Greenfield city means that all the projects which have been undertaken under this mission of smart city are all the fresh and new projects, and there were no ongoing development projects in the city. It is also digitally accessible first smart city in the country. So these two informations make the Naya Raipur city important for us to remember out of the other 10 smart cities. Moving to the smart city's mission, it is an urban renewal and retrofitting program by Government of India. Its mission is to develop 100 smart cities across the country within the span of 5 years, that is from 2017 to 2022. The Union Ministry of Urban Development is responsible for implementing it. It is important for you to remember this. And another important point here to be noted down is that all Indian states and UTs are participating except West Bengal. That is, this state is not a part of the Smart Cities mission. And these two points are very relevant here. Let me tell you that each city will create a corporate company which will be headed by a full-time CEO to implement this mission. And the financial aid will be given by the central and state governments respectively between the 5-year time period. And the share will be 1,000 crore and 500 crore each from the states. So these two contributions would be going to the corporate company, which will be headed by a full-time CEO, and the company will be responsible for the implementation of the Smart City mission. So these were the very important facts about the Smart City mission. You can read more about it whenever you get time. Moving further, Naval Women's Mountaineer Summit, Mount Deutibba. Now here it is important is that an all-women crew from the Navy of India have summited Mount Deutibba. Mount Deutibba is the second highest peak in the Pir Panjal range in Himachal Pradesh. This becomes a fact for you to remember. And secondly, the team of All India Women were led by Lieutenant Commander Kokila Sajwan. So this also becomes a fact for us to remember. Yes, that was all about this news. Tourism Minister launches the new Incredible India website. The Minister of State for Tourism, Shri K.J. Alphonse, has launched the new Incredible India website in New Delhi, the capital city. The website showcases India as a holistic destination revolving around major experiences. The mission of Incredible India website is to promote the tourism in India and to make a clear picture of India as a tourism destination in the world. Now, what is important for us to remember here is that the website has been developed by Tech Mahindra and it is powered by the NIC Cloud, that is National Informatics Center Cloud. So these are the facts for us to remember. Another important point here is that Ministry of Tourism has partnered with Google Arts and Culture in bringing online a series of compelling visuals that will give the user an immersive experience of India's spectacular heritage, festivity, spirituality, all these things which would be online on the website for the viewers. so that their interest is developed in the tourism destinations in India. Okay, that would be all about this. So our next news is Nitin Gadkari releases NABARD publication on water productivity mapping of major Indian crops. Now this particular book, Water Productivity Mapping of Major Indian Crops, is published by NABARD. So that is why this particular book is important for us. And secondly, it has been based on the study of 10 important crops by a team under the leadership of leading agricultural economist Dr. Ashok Gulati. See, Dr. Ashok Gulati is in himself a very important personality, as he has made a lot of contributions to our agricultural economy through various publications of his agricultural analysis. And we have also mentioned here some important crops which are included in these 10 crops. These are rice, wheat, maize, pulses, oilseeds, sugarcane, cotton and potato. So it would be good if you are able to remember these important crops, okay? And secondly, when this book was being launched by the Union Minister for Water Resources, Nitin Gadkari, there was also a proposal for three projects at Tuticorin, Paradip and Kandla. All these three are the major ports of India. And here it is a project is under consideration where seawater can be desalinized and used for irrigation and other works. See, desalinization is making seawater useful, taking out its salt. Now this technology is not used in India yet at a very high scale, but it is being used by various countries like Israel. So if we are able to desalinize the seawater and then use it, it would be of very great help for us, especially in the agricultural economy. Okay, and yes, before moving further, let me tell you what is water productivity. It is the ratio between a unit of output and a unit of input water. That is how much water have we used as input and what is the yield. So the ratio between them give us the water productivity. This is just a fact for us to know if we are going to know about the water productivity mapping of Major Indian Crops book. Okay. That would be all about this news. Let's move further. 20 states sign MOU for the implementation of Ayushman Bharat National Health Protection Mission, that is NHPM. Now see, this mission NHPM is itself important, and before moving to the mission, let me tell you that when these 20 states have signed a memorandum of understanding, a web portal for initiating the empanelment of hospitals under the mission was also launched. That means the implementation is very close to the launch almost in all the states. Let us see about NHPM. It is a newly sponsored scheme of center. That means it is the state and center are going to have their share in the scheme, and it is a mission under the Ministry of Health and Family Welfare. ABNHPM will have a defined benefit cover of rupees 5 lakh per family per year to around 10 crore poor families. So this is assumed to be the largest benefit cover in the entire world, where around 5 lakh per family would be given to 10 crore families. Now the benefit of this scheme is that if you are registered under this scheme, if you are a beneficiary of the scheme, then whatever the benefits are there, they are portable across the country, and the beneficiary will be allowed to take cashless benefits from any public or private empaneled hospitals across the country. That is why the previous slide says the empanelment of hospitals have taken place through the launch of a web portal. And one of the core principles of NHPM is to promote cooperative federalism and flexibility to states. That is, the states would be allowed to flexibly manage and co-alliance with others or other states to promote and maintain this particular mission. That is it. Let's go further. NLCIL's 300 megawatt solar power projects inaugurated. NLCIL stands for Neyveli Lignite Corporation India Limited. Now lignite means it is a coal corporation. Coal is of three types majorly: anthracite, bituminous and lignite. Lignite is the most abundant coal found in India. Now this NLCIL has launched three solar power projects for commercial operation. Okay. And these are situated at Virudhunagar district and Tirunelveli district of the state Tamil Nadu. An MOU was also signed by NLCIL and Anna University to develop a project for the solar drying of lignite. Now, the solar drying of coal is to increase its calorific value, that is the energy value it gives out, from 2700 kilocalorie to 4350 kilocalorie. So this was important for us to know that Anna University is the university with which NLCIL has signed the memorandum of understanding. Let us see a bit more about NLCIL. See, it is a Navaratna profit making company. It's Navaratna, for so we should know it. And it is it was established by Government of India in 1956 in the state of Tamil Nadu. It comes under the administrative control of Ministry of Coal. As I've told you, it is a coal corporation. And yes, that would be it about NLCIL. We should know this much about this corporation. So moving further, June 14th celebrated as World Blood Donor Day. Okay, so instituted by World Health Organization, every year it is celebrated on 14th June. But as it is celebrated every year, so only two important things we need to know. First is that the host country for this year's event is Greece. And secondly, the theme for this year is Be There for Someone Else, Give Blood, Share Life. See guys, that now we are going to see many days which are celebrated on the one day or the other, but what is important for us to know is that if is there any host country for that particular event, or if any theme is given. These are the two most important things about any day. Otherwise, there are so many days celebrated, so you just need to look for these two things particularly. Okay, next news is 106th Science Congress to be hosted by Lovely Professional University in Jalandhar. Now, Jalandhar is a city in Punjab. So, the next year Science Congress is to be held in Punjab. And as you know, this year Science Congress 105th is to be organized in the city of Varanasi. And the theme of this year's event is going to be Future India, Science and Technology. So, this is this year's theme going to be celebrated in Varanasi. Next year going to be celebrated in LPU Jalandhar, and the event is organized by Indian Science Congress Association. Yes, that would be it about this news. Let's move further. DRDO converts Pinaka rocket system into a guided missile. Now see, DRDO has made this Pinaka rocket system indigenously. That is why this is important. Now, this rocket system, which is known for firing a salvo of 12 rockets, it is the first multi-rocket launcher made by DRDO indigenously. So now they are planning to convert this into a precision guided missile. Okay, again, it makes it important. And yes, here it is mentioned that initial version of Pinaka rocket was Mark 1 with a range of 40 kilometers, further developed into Mark 2 with an enhanced range of 70 to 80 kilometers. And after these three, Mark 1, Mark 2 and Pinaka rocket system, DRDO is planning to evolve this system into a missile system. So that would also be important for us to remember. Next news is India to host European Union Film Festival. Now, this film festival is being hosted by India this year. That is why this becomes important for us to remember. It is organized by Directorate of Film Festivals, which is under the Ministry of INB, that is Information and Broadcasting. It was celebrated on 18th June at Siri Fort Auditorium. Now, that would be it about this news. Okay, let me just add that there are 23 EU member states this year which are going to participate in the film festival. Yes, let's move further. Prime Minister to chair the fourth meeting of the Governing Council of Niti Aayog. See, Niti Aayog in itself is a very important body for us to know. And the Governing Council of Niti Aayog is holding a meeting. So I have just mentioned here so that you know that it is the premier body tasked with evolving a shared vision of national development priorities. and it basically reviews the work done during the previous years and deliberates upon the future development priorities. So these are the works of the Governing Council of Niti Aayog. You must know about Niti Aayog in itself and try to go through it whenever you get time. June 15 celebrated as World Elder Abuse Awareness Day. Now again, it is mentioned the theme of this year. It is moving from awareness to action through a human rights based approach. So this is the theme for this year, which is celebrated every year on June 15th. You need to remember the theme of this news. That's it. June 16, celebrated as International Day of Family Remittances. Now see, this particular day, celebration of this day is important for us because India is expected to be the highest receiver of remittances all across the world. India has a very wide diaspora which is spread all across the globe, and they are assumed to send the maximum remittances in their families back. So IDFR, it is celebrated every year on June 16. And the aim for this celebration is to recognize the significant financial contribution migrant workers make to the well-being of their families back home. So this, as India is related to be the highest remittance receiver, so this information becomes important for us. Also, let me tell you that remittances form a very huge part of the BOP, that is balance of payment. Anyway, about balance of payment, we are going to see in the further slide. Now, this news is important. US slaps 25% on $50 billion worth of Chinese good. US President Donald Trump has slapped a stiff tariff on the Chinese goods. See, you would be going to see in news a lot about the tariffs imposed by US on Chinese goods, then on China, and India as well coming into the picture. So see, these three countries are important because with the imposition of such tariffs, there it is expected that in the world economy a trade war has begun. So let us see about some details. The tariff which is imposed by US president is related to the goods which are under the Made in China 2025 strategic plan to dominate the emerging high-tech industries that will drive future economic growth for China. US considers these products as a theft of intellectual property. So let us see what is intellectual property. See, it refers to the creation of mind, such as invention, literary artistic works, designs, symbols, anything. So to protect intellectual property, there are certain laws which are regulated by WTO, that is World Trade Organization, and examples of these IPR, the protection of IPR is done through patents, copyrights, trademarks, etc. So that people who are the inventor are able to earn recognition and even financial benefit from the creation they have made. So let's see. For Japan adopts economic plan to allow more foreign workers. See, as we know, Japan is a country which is going economically and as well as technologically. But Japan's cabinet here has adopted an economic plan, okay, that would allow more foreign workers, as the rapidly aging country, Japan is aging rapidly because the population is not increasing and the current population, the maximum population out of the current is aging. So to promote the workforce, they have adopted this economic plan particularly. The workforce is declining at a very high rate. Under this plan, workers would be allowed to stay in the country for only up to 5 years as visitors, not as immigrants. So this becomes important for us to know that Japan is the country which is planning to adopt economic plans for the coming influx of foreign workers. Whereas you can see, on the other hand, countries like Britain, US are planning to tighten their visa norms. In this background, this news becomes important for us. Maharashtra signs MOU with Canada's Quebec province. So first of all, that which state has signed with which province, okay? And about what? It is about economic cooperation. These two states are going to cooperate economically in the areas like IT, biotechnology, artificial intelligence, and welfare of the tribal community. So these three things are important for us to remember out of this news. Foundation stone of auxiliary production unit and artificial limbs fitting center laid at Nawada, Faridabad. Faridabad is in Haryana, okay? So first of all, that where has this production unit been set up? This is important for us. And secondly, I have mentioned here that this unit works under ALIMCO, that is Artificial Limbs Manufacturing Corporation of India. It is a non-profit making PSU under the Ministry of Social Justice and Empowerment. The ALIMCO is a PSU under Ministry of Social Justice, I have just mentioned, and the production unit being set up in which state or city? You can remember Faridabad, Haryana. That would be all about this news. And yes, let me inform you guys that this production unit, auxiliary production unit and artificial limbs, is the first production unit which has been set up, because people used to, if they have any problem in the limbs, artificial limbs which have been provided, had to go to the headquarters of ALIMCO, which are in Kanpur. So now they would not be they would not have to go to Kanpur every time. It is now near Delhi. It is the Faridabad comes under the NCR region of Delhi, so it would be easy for people to access it. Peggy Whitson, NASA's record-breaking space woman, retires as an astronaut. See, now, as you can see that another astronaut has retired, but why do we need to remember it? The reason is this woman, Peggy Whitson, has so many firsts in her name. Let us see that. She's the world's most experienced female spacewalker. She's the first woman to command International Space Station. And she was the oldest woman to ever fly in space. So also, let me add, first and only women to serve as the chief of NASA's astronaut corps. So now you know that with so many firsts along with her name, Peggy Whitson, when retires, has become an important personality for us to remember. So this news is important for us. RBI eases investment norms for foreign portfolio investors in debt. See, FPI, the RBI has eased norms, as earlier FPIs were allowed only for 20% investors investment in government securities. Now it has been increased to 30%. Now this step will help attract more overseas flows, and it will also lift the recent fall in demand for corporate bonds. The corporate bonds are the ones which are offered by large corporate companies. It will also help in curbing that fall of rupee. And see, to understand this particular news, we need to see a bit about FPIs and FDIs. So let's go to that slide. Foreign portfolio investment consists of securities and other financial assets which are passively held by foreign investors. See, passively means they are not the direct owners of the investment they have done. Rather, they are going to be the indirect owners. FPI is a part of country's capital account under BOP. As you know, BOP consists of capital as well as current account. FPI is a part of capital account. Let me also tell you about BOP. It measures the amount of money flowing from one country to other countries over one monetary year. So overall, in one monetary year, whatever money has come to our country from other countries and what money has gone out will form the BOP of that year. Now BOP has two components, capital account and current account, and FPI is a part of capital account. Now FDI and FBI, let's see a distinction between them. FDI is a long-term investment, that is investment in the physical assets, whereas FPI is a short-term investment in financial assets like government securities, as we have seen in the previous slide. FDI aims to increase the enterprise capacity and also leads to the technology transfer and access to markets. whereas FPI results in only capital inflows. See, let me give you an example. If a company from abroad has decided to invest in India, in the infrastructure, that is to build roads and flyovers, and then they decide one day to leave the country and take back their FDI, it would not be possible for them because the money is invested in the physical assets, whereas in FPI the money is invested in passively in the government securities. So it is relatively easy in FPI to take back your money, whereas it is not for FDI. So for the same reason, FDI does not tend to be speculative, as your money is fixed and you are going to earn the profit from there, you are eligible for that. But in FBI, there is no direct impact and thus speculations are there. So we can see that FPIs are more liquid, that is, they can be converted to cash more easily, and they are also less risky than FDI, because it's not that if you have invested once, it is an investment. So this was about FPI and FDI, and now you'll be able to understand more that why RBI has loosened the norms for the FPI investments in our country. Let's see next news. And there's the plenary meeting held in Jurmala, Latvia. See, nuclear suppliers group is an important group for us because India, being a member of Wassenaar group, Australia group and certain other groups, is not a member of NSGE yet. Although India has applied for NSGE's membership in 2016 at the Seoul plenary session, but it has not received any response yet. It is assumed that few countries, including China, are blocking India's way into the NSGE membership. So this is the reason that we are looking to NSGE, and this meeting, which was held in Latvia, becomes important for us to remember. Also, NSGE has 48 members, where all the members took place in this meeting. Yes, that would be it about this news. COMCASA, US experts to discuss key military agreements with India. See, COMCASA stands for Communication, Compatibility and Security Agreement. Now, this meeting in Washington DC between Sushma Swaraj and Nirmala Sitharaman and the counterparts is known as the 2+2 discussion. 2+2 as in the Ministry of External Affairs as well as Defense Ministry with their counterparts are meeting together. And in the next slide, I have mentioned the importance. See, COMCASA will facilitate the transfer of encrypted communication satellites. These are going to be very important. Communication systems and not the satellites. The agreements are a key requirement by Washington for sharing high-tech military hardware. The sale of armed drones is on the high agenda of 2+2 dialogue. That is, India is going to buy these drones from US. Yes, one more important fact here is that India has signed LIMOA, that is Logistics Exchange Memorandum of Agreement. According to this agreement, the two nations, US and India, can share their naval bases, their military bases, if in the time of need or war. So this is also important that India has already signed LIMOA and the COMCASA meet held under the 2+2 dialogue. Let's move. Okay, so the year of 2018 is being celebrated as the year of disabled soldiers in the line of duty. So this pretty information is important for us, that 2018 is celebrated to the disabled soldiers. And yes, under this endeavor, one-time financial assistance to disabled soldiers who have been boarded out of service on medical grounds is to be given to them. So yes, that would be it about this news. So our next news is Regional Conference of Western States on Water Resources held in Mumbai. See, this Conference of Western States on Water Resources is important for us because we have seen in news about the water dispute going on between the Tamil Nadu and Karnataka state. on the sharing of the river water of Kaveri. So this, in the background of that particular information, this news becomes important. There are 5 western states involved in this meet. These are Karnataka, Madhya Pradesh, Maharashtra, Gujarat and Goa. This meet was held in June 2018, and this gives an opportunity for studying details of many pending issues which are related to the main issue, that is the water disputes. All these factors, whatever would be discussed in the meet, would be put forward to Niti Aayog so that they can come up with the new schemes. See, Niti Aayog is one of the agencies for the implementation of sustainable development goals in India, and the dispute redressal about the water and such resources comes under sustainable development as well. So in this background, this is important for us. And these were the important takeaways. You need to know that what are the 5 western states and where was the meet held. That is it. The next news says regional training camp on socio-economic survey on drinking water, sanitation, hygiene and housing condition has been held, and it was launched by NSSO. NSSO is the premier field survey under the office of MOSPI, that is Ministry of Statistics and Program Implementation. So this is most important about this news, that you must know what is NSSO and under the aegis of which ministry it functions. Yes, that would be it. Dhanush artillery gun clears 3rd and final trial. See, the Dhanush artillery gun is an upgraded version of Swedish Bofors gun, which was procured by India in mid-1980s, and it is upgraded indigenously. That makes it important. Dhanush gun has completed the final user trials and is ready for the induction into army. So these two things are important, that first one, it is upgraded indigenously, and second, it is going to be inducted into the army very recently. So these are about the two important informations from this news. You can also see that the test firing took place in the Pokhran field firing range in Rajasthan. Pokhran is the place where even our nuclear tests were conducted for the first time. SAARC Development Fund to launch Social Enterprise Development Program. See, before moving to this, let me tell you about SAARC. SAARC is the South Asian Association for Regional Cooperation. It has 8 members: Afghanistan, Bangladesh, Bhutan, India, Nepal, Maldives, Pakistan and Sri Lanka. It is based in Kathmandu, Nepal. And it will be the SAARC Development Fund is going to launch an enterprise to fund 80 entities annually across 8 member states, and it is going to be headquartered in Thimphu. So this was the most important thing, that SDF going to be developed is going to be headquartered in Bhutan, and SAARC itself is headquartered in Nepal. That is it. June 17, World Day to Combat Desertification and Drought. See, UNCCD, the United Nations Convention to Combat Desertification, has declared year 2006 as the year of desertification. So, the World Day to Combat is celebrated every year on June 17. June 17, because this date marks the adoption of United Nations Convention by UNGA in 1994. The theme for this year is Land Has True Value, Invest in It. So you must know about UNCCD, as it has been doing a lot of work in the field of combating desertification. Second, the June 17 day is celebrated. Thirdly, what is the theme for this year's World Day to Combat Desertification? See, one more point I would like to add here is that UNCCD is combating desertification in the countries wherever there are land degradation going on due to the deserts. It's not only in Africa, but particularly in Africa, because there are so many deserts in Africa. So you don't need to get confused that UNCCD has to work only in Africa. It is working in Africa as well as other countries wherever there is land degradation. Yes, Russia successfully launches GLONASS-M satellite using Soyuz 2.1B carrier rocket. See, GLONASS, first of all, let me tell you about this. It is an acronym for Global Navigation Satellite System. It is an basically alternative to GPS, that is Global Positioning System, which is the navigation system of the US. GLONASS is a space-based navigation system. It is operating in the Radio Navigation Satellite Service. Another important information I would like to tell you here is that India has its own NAVIC satellite system which is operational. Okay, so GLONASS, NAVIC, that is navigation with Indian constellation, and GPS. You need to know all these systems. And here the news says that Russia has launched GLONASS M satellite using the Soyuz carrier. Okay, it is a part of GLONASS, the system which we have spoken about right now. And it provides real-time positioning data for surface, sea, and airborne projects around the globe. Yes, that would be it. India notifies WTO of its decision to impose higher import tariffs on 30 US goods. See, World Trade Organization, as we spoke about the economic war which is going to be expected to take off, India has notified the tariff on US goods. China has also announced higher tariffs on the American agricultural exports. This move has come after New Delhi received a cold shoulder from Washington DC on its request for exemption. India was not given exemption, so in lieu, India has notified WTO for imposing tariffs on US as well. So you need to just keep a view over these such informations coming every day. So that was all, guys. June 14 to June 18 news coverage in detailing. If you have any query, you can drop us a mail at hello@edutab.co.in. You can even give us a call at 8146207241. You can even visit our website www.edutab.co.in. So thank you, guys. Have a happy learning. If you like this video, please like and subscribe and share. Thank you.